Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, Planet 9, hold on, not so fast. Lisa Pathfinder gets to the L1 point, and galaxy clusters teach us a little bit more about dark matter. Remember in last week's episode, I told you about how Caltech astronomers Constantine Batygin and Mike Brown ran simulations of distant Kuiper Belt objects to try and explain why six of the objects had very unlikely orbits around the solar system? Their work provided the best evidence yet hinting at the possibility of a large planet in orbit around in the distant solar system. Now, this planet has not been seen yet, and you can bet astronomers will be scrambling to get time on the world's telescopes to try and see it. But many astronomers remain skeptical that anyone will find anything. In a post dated January 20th on his blog, Starts with a Bang, astronomer Dr. Ethan Siegel provides a pretty good summary of the evidence against the idea of a planet being the cause of the strange orbits seen in the distant KBOs. After summarizing how planets have usually been detected in our solar system and outlining the basics of the Caltech research, and saying that wouldn't it be hugely ironic if the guy who killed Pluto as a planet, that would be Dr. Mike Brown, also discovered a real ninth planet in our solar system. Dr. Siegel says there are consequences if there is a huge planet out there, and he named three of them. But to me, the most compelling argument against there being a ninth planet in orbit hundreds of astronomical units away lies with the data from the Infrared All-Sky Survey done by NASA's Wide Field Infrared Explorer, also called WISE. Now, a key thing I should point out before going any further about a distant planet lurking hundreds of astronomical units away is that while they would be extremely difficult to see with reflected light, like we do with most of the time when looking at planets with telescopes, a distant massive planet of the size proposed here would radiate relatively brightly in the infrared, just like Jupiter does. WISE imaged the entire sky twice in the infrared between 2010 and 2011 before it was eventually turned off in 2011. And during that time, its detectors were sensitive enough to detect a Neptune-sized object out to 700 AU in the IR, and it could have seen a larger object of 2 to 3 Jupiter masses at a distance of up to 7 to 10 light years. Now, having said that, Neptune is not very bright in WISE data, so the hypothetical planet is on the lower side of WISE's sensitivity. So sadly, NASA had announced long ago, back in March 2014, that there was no evidence of what they were calling at the time Planet X, and found that no object the size of Saturn or larger exists out to a distance of 10,000 astronomical units. And what's more, there was no object larger than Jupiter out to 26,000 AU. So even WISE data doesn't completely rule out a ninth planet due to its presumed dimness at the limits of the WISE detectors, but it is a powerful piece of evidence against there being one. NASA's WISE mission was one of the most interesting they had going at the time, and a lot of great discoveries came out of it, including studying the most luminous galaxy in the universe that I mentioned just last week. It also discovered a whole new class of cool stars and finding millions of hidden black holes. But sorry, unfortunately, it largely ruled out any large planets that are out in the outer solar system. Now, another cool little tidbit about WISE is that NASA reactivated the satellite in 2014 and renamed it NEO-WISE, with the main purpose of finding and tracking asteroids that may pose a threat to the Earth. So, go NEO-WISE! So while there is hope that maybe there is a planet 900s of astronomical units distant, there's also good reasons to be skeptical. As Dr. Ethan Siegel points out, a large-sized planet may be an explanation for the orbits of these strangely aligned KBOs, but it may not be the best explanation. And I'm sure we'll hear lots more about this as the year unfolds. I'll keep you posted. Next, here's a follow-up to a story I did back in SFN 144 about ESA's LISA Pathfinder mission. Last week, the spacecraft arrived at its destination, the L1 point. The L1 point is a spot in orbit 1.5 million kilometers away from Earth that matches our orbit and follows us on our journey around the Sun. LISA Pathfinder was launched back in December, and its arrival at L1 came after a final thruster burn using the spacecraft's propulsion module on January 20th. The small 64-second firing was designed to slightly change its speed and to just barely tip the craft onto its new orbit around L1. After the burn, the propulsion module was successfully ejected, and now the fun begins. As I reported earlier, LISA Pathfinder is a spacecraft designed to test the technology required to detect gravitational waves in space. Now, finding these waves is very difficult, but important if we are to understand the large-scale structure of the universe, the nature of black holes, the property of the early universe, including the time close to the Big Bang, and many other fundamental questions. It will put two test masses in a near-perfect gravitational freefall and control and measure their motion with unprecedented accuracy. To do this, it will use inertial sensors, a laser metrology system, a drag-free control system, and an ultra-precise micro-propulsion system. The aim of the LISA Pathfinder mission is to demonstrate in a space environment that free-falling bodies follow geodesics, the equivalent of straight lines in curved space, in space-time by more than two orders of magnitude better than any past, present, or planned mission. So there will be a Future in Space hangout coming in spring with some of the scientists working on the mission to talk about some of the results. So please subscribe to the event page on Deep Astronomy's Facebook page to be notified of when that will happen. And there's a link to that in the description box. Finally, it seems like every year we learn more about the nature of dark matter. And this week, astronomers studying galaxy clusters have expanded our knowledge on this stuff a little bit more. Now, for those of you who don't know, dark matter is the stuff that makes up about 27% of everything in the universe. And the problem is, we have no idea what it actually is, because it won't interact with us in any way. But that doesn't mean we can't find some stuff out about it. This week, astronomers studying approximately 9,000 galaxy clusters from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey DR8 Galaxy Catalog got some new insight into dark matter and its effects on these clusters. Galaxy clusters, which consist of thousands of galaxies, are important for exploring dark matter because they reside in a region where dark matter is much denser than average. And scientists believe that the heavier a cluster is, the more dark matter it has in its environment. But this new research suggests that the connection is more complicated than that. Astronomers divided the clusters in SDSS into two groups by their internal structures, one in which the individual galaxies within the cluster were more spread out, and one in which they were closely packed together. Now, the scientists use a technique you've heard me talk about before, gravitational lensing, which is looking at how the gravity of clusters bends light from other objects, to confirm that both groups had similar masses. Now, I've talked about gravitational lensing many times before, and I have a video on it, so I won't go into that here. But when the researchers compared the two groups, they found an important difference in the distribution of galaxy clusters. Now, normally, galaxy clusters are separated from other galaxy clusters by about 100 million light years on average. But for the group of clusters with tightly packed galaxies, there were fewer neighboring galaxies at this distance than for the sparser clusters. In other words, the surrounding dark matter environment determined how packed a cluster is with galaxies. So, in addition to being important in determining a galaxy cluster's mass, dark matter also has a role to play in how closely packed a galaxy cluster is. Well, good. One last thing. We will get you, dark matter. We will get you. Well, that's it for this week, space fans. Thanks to all the Patreon supporters for helping to make SFN better, and thanks to all of you for watching. And as always, keep looking up.